worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you.
Never stop working. Even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working.
Good morning and Happy New Year. I'm Lori Catarba. I'm Pastor Mark's assistant, and I'm also the ministry's assistant here at First United Methodist Church. We're so glad that you're here to join us. Can you believe 2021? Boy, we are looking forward to all the wonderful things that 2021 has to offer us. Today, Pastor Mark will be talking about new beginnings. Next week, he's going to start a new sermon series called Christian Vocabulary 101. So be sure you stay tuned for that next week. So welcome. If this is your first time with us, we offer you a special welcome. If you have any questions about our church or any questions about being a United Methodist in general, just give us a call. We're so glad you're here.
Is this cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest droughts and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease, my comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ.
Hi, I'm Amy. Happy New Year! We have just celebrated Christmas and filled our hearts with the hope, peace, love, and joy of Jesus. Now it is the new year, time for us to go out into the world and carry all that goodness with us. When we put away the Christmas decorations, we do not put away the blessings of Christ's birth. Let us start the new year sharing the hope, peace, love, and joy of Jesus wherever we go. Share some love. Maybe you could draw a picture or write a card to someone you haven't seen in a while. Think of the joy you would bring to your family by offering to help around the house. Choose to be kind. Show someone that there is hope and peace in the world. Will you pray with me? Dear Lord, thank you for the blessings of Christmas. Help me to share your blessings with everyone in the new year. Amen.
We have three passages today. The first comes from the book of Isaiah, chapter 40, verses 28 to 31. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. And from the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 35 to 39. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And the third reading is from the book of Ephesians, chapter 4, verses 31 and 32. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
I am hopeful that everyone I care about and love stays healthy during the season.
Hey Anthony, what are you hopeful for in the new year?
I'm hopeful for being at my new job during a bit away at the safe service in the Army. Happy New Year.
My hope for the new year is that we can have peace and togetherness and happiness for everybody. And no more dissension. I want us all to be together and love each other.
Hi, my name is Joshua Gurnall. My hope for 2021 is that we put this pandemic behind us, everybody puts their differences aside, and everybody comes together as a nation and we rebuild our nation. And my personal hope is that I just become a great father. That's it.
Right on. Hi, I'm Julian Schlottman, and my hope for 2021 is healthiness, paying attention to our growth physically and spiritually, becoming more in tune with God as my creator, and being thankful just for every day opening my eyes. And I feel blessed, and I know a lot of us out there may be in the slums right now, sort of say, with the way the world is turning, but I'm here to tell you that, you know, your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, loves you, and he's there for you, and don't ever feel as if he ain't. Alright? Amen.
Hopeful for 2021. I would say certainly that the vaccine works. That would be great. But I think beyond that, maybe what I would love to see is the folks that have been going beyond themselves, looking outward rather than inward, and helping others, and putting their time and energies into areas of need. I'd love to see that continue into 2021.
Good morning. My hope for 2021 is that all of you will be very healthy and happy. I also hope that we have a vaccination for all of the nation and that the COVID virus will be gone. My hope is that we will all be able to get back together for church and be together to worship, and that life will resume to be normal again. That is my hope for 2021. Happy New Year, everyone.
Happy New Year, everyone. We're glad that you're with us here at First United Methodist Church as we begin a new year together. You just saw a series of little videos of people sharing their hopes and dreams for 2021. And all of us, we have this hope and this expectation that the new year will be one of new beginnings for each and every one of us. The truth is, 2020 was a dumpster fire of a year. I'm just being very honest and straightforward with you. And I can give you a litany of lowlights over the past year. But even in the midst of the pain that we had and experienced during 2020, there were also some blessings. We've seen babies being born. We've seen families coming together. We find people coming together, supporting one another. We have seen the heroic efforts of our doctors and our nurses and of our scientists as they try to tackle this pandemic. The air is actually cleaner than it has been for years. But here's a very important thing to remember about this year. 2020 taught us to recognize that life is too fragile and short to be taken for granted. It's in this recognition that we discover the power of hope. Paul says these words, "Who can ever separate us from the love of God? Will hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I'm convinced that neither life nor death, nor things present nor things to come, nor rulers, nor heights, nor depths, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God made known to us in Christ Jesus our Lord." Those are incredible, hopeful words. And the scriptures that Lori shared with you as part of our lesson demonstrated that no matter how difficult or hard things might become, God is there to uplift us. God is there to strengthen us. God is there to give us hope. What Paul offered in his words of hope was to give strength and to sustain the early church in times of persecution and uncertainty about what tomorrow was going to bring them. You see that just because we've embraced the dawn of a new year, the sad truth is that the darkness of the pandemic is still an ever-present specter. And that is why we need hope. And hope becomes that sunrise of a new beginning for each and every one of us as we journey through this landscape of a post-pandemic world, whatever that might look like. Life as we once knew it changed for us. In our journey, you see the old familiar guideposts that we once followed are no longer there, or they have been moved somewhere else. And so the challenge for every one of us is that we have to journey together and sometimes forge a new trail. And in doing so, we hope to encounter and to share God's love and grace and compassion to all who may pass our way or to those who wish to follow us. Yes, life has changed, but it can change for the better. And that's what we're hopeful for. And nothing in this world, not even a pandemic, can ever steal away the hope that God gives us as we embrace the future. And sometimes we don't know, and often we don't know what that future is going to hold. But we know that God holds the future, and that God holds us in the palm of His hand. So that is why I really want to focus on hope, because hope becomes that essential spiritual and emotional force that will bring each and every one of us to that place of new beginnings, to have a new start, to have a new lease on life. God promised never to leave nor forsake us. And God gives us new beginnings every single day, new opportunities, so that we can grow and that we can mature spiritually and emotionally, that we can leave the past behind us. Maybe we've learned some lessons along the way, but now our focus is set on the future, on how you and I can, we all can make a difference in offering the gift of God's love to a shattered and broken world. Now, we are actually still in the Christmas season. There are the 12 days of Christmas. There are 12 days after Christmas that is part of that season of us focusing on the birth of Christ and on the wise men who came to visit, and how it was a light that guided the Magi to the stable and to Christ. And if anything, we need a light. A light to guide us as we enter into this new year of 2021. Now, again, as I said, Christmas is really pretty much as a week in the past or so. And I remember this year watching It's a Wonderful Life. I hope you had a chance to see that traditional uplifting movie about George Bailey and and about Clarence the Angel. Now, I've seen that movie, oh, many, many times. But this year, it really spoke to me. The whole premise of the movie resonated with me in a different way, especially as we have walked through 2020. I discovered that it was more than just a holiday feel-good movie. What it was a parable. It was a parable about faithfulness. It's a parable about family and responsibility. But mostly, it is a parable about hope and God's intervention in our lives to bring us hope, but also give us a new opportunity to look to the future with clearer focus, as well as we examine our own lives and discover how each and every one of us, how we can make a difference. But you know the story of George Bailey. He's one of those great guys. He had dreams, but somehow along the way, something happened that put an end to some of his own dreams, but God opened up other opportunities for him to be an incredible and integral part of the community in which he lived. Now again, you're familiar with the story that a crisis comes into George Bailey's life. The banking examiner comes, and George finds out that there is a shortfall because of his Uncle Billy losing the money and Mr. Potter, the old man Potter, who finds it and instead of returning it, holds on to it in order to destroy George Bailey's life. Now, on top of that, his daughter Zuzu, she comes down with the sniffles, and throughout the day, despair builds up within George Bailey. And when the teacher called to find out how Zuzu was doing, you remember how George Bailey takes the phone and just bawls out and ridicules the Zuzu's teacher. And then Zuzu's teacher's husband comes on the line, and George Bailey and him have an argument, a confrontation over the phone. Now, George has a breakdown. That's what it was. He had an emotional and spiritual breakdown. His whole life came crashing down around him. He was certain he was going to lose everything. The building loan, his family, that there would be scandal if the money wasn't found or recovered. And so he goes out, storms out of the house, and there he goes for a drink. And sitting there, he offers a prayer of despair to God. He admits that he's not a praying man, but he asks God to intervene and to show him what to do. And two of his friends, you know, they try to talk him to go back home, and they call my name. And then there was the gentleman, the teacher's husband, sitting at the end of the bar, who asks, "Is this George Bailey?" And he walks over and hits George, knocking him to the floor. And George touches his lip, noticing that it was bleeding. And he says these words, "This is what I get for praying." He checks to see if his insurance policy is still in his jacket, and he heads out to do the unthinkable thing in his despair. George decides to put an end to his life. And he walks, goes over to the bridge, and he looks down. And well, sure, as George was going to get ready to jump, here comes Clarence coming down into the water. And George, by his very nature, forgets about himself and his own problems, jumps in and saves Clarence. And you know, Clarence is the guardian angel that intervenes into George's life. And he showed George what life would be like if he never had been born. And George discovers that by his sheer lack of living, of his compassion, of his mercy, of the fact that he cared for people, even though his own personal dreams fell by the wayside, there was something about his life and about his character that actually transformed a society, a community, a people. It was George Bailey who gave individuals hope. Hope of a new home. Hope of a new life. And Clarence showed George that what life would be like for so many others if he never have been alive. And then he pointed out, George, isn't life such a wonderful gift? It's a wonderful gift. And you're going to throw it all away. Think of all the good you have done, George. And that is what God calls us to do. I know 2020 was a year that challenged us, that left us in despair. We have lost loved ones and friends. There's an empty seat at the table now for so many people. Our politics have deteriorated, where there is little or no civil discourse any longer. And the fact is that this despair is still there. But we have to also recognize that God gives us the strength and the power and the hope to overcome and make a difference. Even in our own sphere of influence, we can make a difference. And that's what 2021 can bring to each and every one of us. An opportunity to make a difference. So how do we find hope? And to keep hope alive in the midst of not only this new year, but in the uncertainties of life itself. As much as, again, 2020 has been a real dumpster fire of a year. There was so much more that happened to offer us hope. I want to show a little video clip for you that is a wonderful inspirational message about some of the important things that came our way and important lessons we have learned and can learn from 2020 and how we can apply those important lessons to our lives, to our spirituality, as we live out a hopeful 2021. I'll get back to you after the video.
It's interesting that the things we cherish most are the same things we walk right by. They become so intertwined in the status quo that ultimately it becomes impossible to tell them apart from our day-to-day. That is, impossible until things change. Because as it turns out, that thing we call life, it has a say. There's a saying, you never really know what you have until it's gone. And sometimes it takes the most abrasive of reminders, the harshest of times, to help us recapture that perspective, to lift us up and show us what we had previously failed to see. And while our darkest moments test our strength, they push our boundaries, even transform our reality, they can also be the bridge that leads us exactly where we need to be. They remind us that sometimes it's not about how we spend our time, but who we spend it with. That quiet brings clarity. And the world can spin so fast that we forget to think about our place within it. It reminds us how humanity is bigger than the sum of its parts. And it takes just as much energy to build up as it does to tear down. It reminds us that no matter where we live, what we speak, or who we pray to, we're not so different after all. It reminds us that there is so much more good in this world than evil, so much more love than hate, and so much promise for tomorrow. Someday we'll look back on this moment with the lessons we've learned, the hardships we've faced, and we will be reminded of the miracle that is the human spirit, unwavering in its resolve, unbreakable at its foundation, stronger than we could ever comprehend. See, sometimes it's hard to look around and find a reason to be optimistic, to understand or comprehend why. But what we'll find is that if we look hard enough, immersed in the uncertainty, the disruption, and in some cases, the tragedy, there's something to be gained. A tiny candle flickering in the night that will eventually grow to light our way. Because that road to tomorrow is paved with hope. There are pages unwritten, stories untold, and a new chapter to begin.
I hope that this video inspired you. And I want us always to remember and never forget that there is a universal need for hope. Hope in the ordinary aspects of our lives. Hope that can well up in the midst of the turmoil and the uncertainty that we feel. A hope that can lead us out of the fog of our own selfishness and to bring us to that place of readiness in which we can endure anything that the world can throw at us. A hope that will allow us, as the prophet Isaiah says, to mount up on wings like an eagle. Amen to that. The great theologian William Barclay said this in his commentary on the book of Romans and in the words of Paul. And he speaks this about hope, and I want to conclude with this. The Christian hope is the hope which has seen everything and endured everything and still has not despaired, because it believes in God. The Christian hope is not hope in a human spirit, in human goodness alone, in human endurance, in human achievement. The Christian hope is the hope found in the power of God. And may that power of God resonate and speak to your heart, especially as we begin this new year together. There's going to be challenges. There's going to be pitfalls. But remember that there are going to be blessings too. And we hope in that. And we keep our eyes wide open for the presence of God and God winking at us, reminding us that even in the midst of our despair, we are never alone. So don't take your life for granted. Don't take the blessings that you have given. When the pandemic subsides, reconnect. Reconnect with your family. Reconnect with friends. Reconnect in your community where you can make a difference. Find ways you can be part of your church and spiritual family. Find ways that your life can be turned around. And like George Bailey, when he comes to that place of epiphany, realizing that he did have a wonderful life. And I pray for you that you can experience that wonderful life of God's grace and love in your journey. Let us pray together. Loving and gracious God, we just want to thank you. Thank you for this new year. And we know, Lord God, 2020 was a year of challenges, a year of despair and uncertainty. And though we are never promised tomorrow, help us, Lord God, to live in the certainty of your power and your love and of your hope. Because we know that nothing in creation can ever take that away. Amen. Amen, everyone, and God's richest blessings to you. Shalom.
Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son and make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon his cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom.
Almighty God, to You all hearts are open, all desires known, and from You no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of Your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love You and worthily magnify Your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Christ, our Lord, invites to His table all who love Him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. And therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Let us in one voice come to God in confession. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved You with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church, and we have not done Your will. We have broken Your law. We have rebelled against Your love, and we have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray in silence, confessing our own sins before God for all that we have done and that which we failed to do. The Lord be with you. And also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and to give our thanks and praise. It is a right and good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to You, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in Your image, and You breathed into us the breath of life. And when we've turned away and our love failed, Your love remained always steadfast. You delivered us from captivity and made a covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through Your prophets, and so with Your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise Your name and join in the unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of Your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. On the night that He gave Himself up for us, He took the bread, He gave thanks to You, broke the bread, and gave it to His disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is My body given for you. Do it in remembrance of Me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, he gave thanks to you, and gave it to his disciples and said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood, the new covenant that has been poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of this in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ, offering for us as we proclaim now the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine, and make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. And by your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to the whole world, until Christ comes again in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with your Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we partake of the one loaf. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. You may eat the bread. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. You may now drink the cup. Eternal God, we give thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself for us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us share now in the prayer that our Lord has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we have forgiven those who have trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.